Hello friends, this is Chandrakant from Akulmak and I welcome you all to Legal Matters. And today we want to discuss something very, very specific to India. And as you know that in India, there is reservations for certain category of people. And you know, sometimes if you are in government sector, you are exposed to this. And if you're in private sector, you are not really exposed to these things. So we will invite our expert today to know more about this reservation, how it has affected us and who is eligible. So let me invite my friend from Ahmedabad, the great lawyer, Mr. Jeet Bhatt.
Thank you, Chandrakant. And I'm looking forward for this session.
So how was the Christmas holidays treating you?
Well, it is good to be at home and celebrating Christmas with family rather than going out and going outside in this COVID situation. So we are comfortable at our home.
Very good, Jeet. So I think our listeners and viewers would like to know first, what is this reservation and how this impacts the society by and large? So you can just start by giving your inputs on this reservation.
Yes, Chandrakant. In fact, it's a very important topic in this. And reservation in public sector, civil services, government departments, and also in public and private educational institutions, which reserves certain seats for the socially and educationally backward classes, the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribe. Now, basically, if you see under the constitution, which guarantees right to equality to every citizen under Article 14. But this right to equality also means that equals have to be treated equally and unequals cannot be treated equally because you need different layers wherein you can't treat the topmost layer of the society with the bottommost layer of the society. That is not the concept of equality. Also, under Article 15 and 16, which is also regarding the right to equality, it provides that the state cannot deny the equality of the equal opportunity only on the basis of race, caste, sex, religion, etc. But it also, under the subclause 15 clause 3 and 16 clause 4 of the constitution provide that nothing in these clauses would prevent the state from laying down certain policies to benefit these backward classes and socially and educationally backward communities, as well as it can make provisions for women and also for physically handicapped people, because a well-built person cannot, and a physically disabled person, you can't treat both of them equally because both needs different parameters. A physically handicapped person cannot compete with a normal person. So therefore, these backward communities, these physically disabled people, even including women, they need certain measures to bring them into the mainstream. And therefore, that is what is known as the right to equality. Because if we deny them these treatments, then we are not treating them equal and we are not providing them the platform which would bring them into the mainstream and which would alleviate their condition and bring them to the, which will give them the proper fundamental rights which they deserve. So therefore, reservations are not an exception to the right to equality, but they are a facet of the right to equality and they foster equality. And therefore, they are provided under the constitutional framework. And there is a National Commission for Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe, which is provided under Article 338 of the Constitution. And when the Constitution was drafted, there was a constitutional scheduled caste list, which was created in the year 1950, which prescribed for around 1108 castes, which are termed to be as scheduled castes. Around as scheduled tribes. So the list is provided under this list, and they are to be provided reservations as per their population in different parts of the country. So reservation is provided in public employment, civil services, government departments, and also in all public and private educational institutions. So it is provided for seats reserved in educational institutions, for seats to be filled in public employment, and also provided for promotional avenues. Normally, we see around 15% seats are reserved for scheduled caste, around 7-8% are reserved for scheduled tribe, and around 27% seats are reserved for other than backward class, that is OBC, which is also which is derived from socially and educationally backward classes. So in 1979, it was felt that apart from SC and ST, there are several other backward classes which are not part of the mainstream in the society. And therefore, a Mandal Commission was set up in the year 1979, which studied the entire country and various castes and classes, and came to the conclusion that there are around more than 3,700 classes which are backward classes, are socially and economically backward. And they provided that some reservation should also be provided for them. And ultimately, it led to the famous case of Indira Sani, which is also known as Mandal Commission case, wherein in 1992, the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court upheld the reservation for the backward classes, but provided a ceiling limit, saying that reservation in no case can be more than 50% of the available seats. So reservation provided for the backward communities like scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and OBCs, the SEBC, cannot be more than 50% in any state in the country for the available seats. So this type of reservation for backward classes is also known as vertical reservation. Because what has happened is that then reservation is also provided for women, also for physically handicapped candidates, also for ex-servicemen, and for relatives of freedom fighter. So this reservation, if you calculate with the vertical reservation for SC, ST, and SEBC, which comes to around 49%, and then add 33% for women, 3% for physically handicapped, and so and so for these people, ex-servicemen, it would become 80-90%. So what the Supreme Court held is that there are two types of reservations. One is vertical reservation, the other is horizontal reservation. So vertical reservation is for the backward classes, and horizontal reservation is also known as special reservation, is for women, physically handicapped, ex-servicemen, etc. So the special reservation for women physically handicapped is termed as horizontal reservation, and it cuts across the horizontal reservation. So it does not increase the reservation beyond 50%, but what it does is it cuts across and it is compartmentalized. So in order to understand this better, I would give an example. So for example, if there are 100 seats available for say a post of police inspector, and 51 seats are for open category, and 49 seats are reserved for backward communities like scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, and OBC. Now, if there are women, 33% reserved seat for women, then from 100 total seats, 33 seats would be reserved for women. But this would not mean that 77 other seats are reserved for men alone. Women can compete with men in open category as well as in reserved category. But the requirement is that 33% seats have to be filled of women. It cannot be less than that. So 33% seats for women will have to be filled. Now, if we look into the compartments, say, for example, for open category. So 51 seats for open category, wherein, as per the judgments of Supreme Court, even the reserved category and the backward category can compete. And if they, on their own merit, are selected into the open category, then their numbers in their reserved category would not be depleted, or it will not affect them. Because in open category, there is no reservation. So any person being in any caste or tribe or in any community can compete in the open and general category, and if he is selected on his merit in open category, then that person would so the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes and OBCs reservation seats do not get affected, so they compete with the general category. So likewise, for 51 seats to be filled in open category, the 33% of 51 seats would be 17 seats. So 17 seats in open category will have to be filled by women. And if there are, so what has to be done in the and what is done actually in the employment or agencies is that they create a first merit list of say around 100 or 120 candidates who have been selected in accordance with merit and in accordance with their caste reservation. So out of that first 51 would be the general category. They are appointed as per their merit. They are in the top. So if from that 51, they will identify that whether there are 17, so that is 33% women, 17 seats of women are there or not. If there are 17 women in that list of 51, then that horizontal reservation is complete. 33% seats are there. And woman categories reservation is complete. So there is no need to further add more woman category into it. But suppose, say for example, if there are only 10 women and 17 seats for women are reserved as per 33% reservation, then what is to be done is that from that list of 51, because there is a shortfall of 7 women, these 7 men who are selected at the bottom will have to be deleted. And from that list of 51 towards the end list, 7 women will have to be identified who are in accordance with their merit. And if 7 women are found, then those 7 women, though they are below in the select list, but they will, because of this reservation, they will find place in the top 51. And if 17 women are found, then that list is complete and then those 51 persons can be appointed. Likewise, for scheduled caste, say for example, 15 seats are reserved for 15% reservation. So 33% will have to be reserved for women. So that would come to around, say, 5 seats. So if 5 seats are reserved for women and in that list of 15 for scheduled caste, if 5 women are there, then that 33 reservation is complete. But say for example, there's 5 women are not available in the top 15 per list of scheduled caste, then the bottom, say for example, 2 women are there and out of 5 seats. So then the list will have to be seen and 3 women will have to be picked which are of scheduled caste and which will have to be brought into that list of 15.
So Jeet, I think you are explaining the horizontal and vertical. I think this gets quite complex, and that is a challenge as a country we have. For example, you mentioned that there are more than 4,000 different caste categories which are covered under reservation. I will like to draw your attention to one aspect which is related to getting the person into the area where you want him to be. Basically, the reservation is to bring the equality among everyone, all citizens of India. That was the motive behind getting the reservation done. However, you can allow this person to get into this category, but you can't allow him to succeed when he actually passes through an examination, for instance, as an example. So let's say, as you grow in life, your complexities of handling situations also grows along with the age. So when you're in school, then there is no problem. There is a reservation because everybody is going to study the same thing. As you grow in your education and how far you can go is basically determined by how much you can, how many exams you can clear. So you can get into management, you can get into MPhil, you can get into PhD. All that is determined by how many exams you can clear. The whole point is that if your score is less, then obviously you will not clear the exam. So you give the reservation, get people from all these 4,000 different categories and subcategories and the general category together so that everybody is equal. But when they go through the examination filtration, then many of these people who do not have reached that point based on meritocracy will not be able to cross that threshold. So I think, in my opinion, as a layman, I feel that I think this is not a right method of bringing equality. What is your opinion on that?
Well, as you said, meritocracy ultimately suffers because, especially in educational institutions, we find that a lot of deserving candidates are not given seats in top institutions, and less deserving candidates of these reserved classes get appointed. But basically, that is the policy which has been established in this country since the constitution was drafted. And therefore, it is not correct to say that this policy is flawed or it is not correct. In fact, affirmative action is required. And because when you see the condition of what these communities was when the when we became independent, it was terrible. They had no freedom, they had no rights, they were treated in extreme bad situations. So it was necessary to alleviate their condition. Therefore, this reservation policy was provided, and it has consistently grown, though it should decrease, because since 70 years, we can't keep on increasing these reservation policies, because ultimately it affects meritocracy. But with regards to employment, if you see, then this applies only to government and the institutions which are funded by government. So, which amounts to only 10% in the entire sector, if you consider in India. The rest of the 90% of SC and ST and tribe population is employed in private sector, where there is no need for reservation. So education is what is important, and yes, to an extent, ultimately the government will have to decide, rather than increasing and expanding the scope of reservation, it should ultimately bring it to meritocracy. But in order to curb this reservation, what they have provided is for the term called creamy layer. So the creamy layer, so those whose situation has increased or has been better, improved in last so many years, so whose family's annual income is more than 8 lakhs. So those other than backward classes, so socially and educationally backward classes, who otherwise would get the reservation, would be kept out of this reservation if they are in the creamy layer. So therefore, those communities whose situation has improved over the years and whose income is better, or whose parents are in government jobs, or who have good jobs, their kids would not be entitled to reservation. So that is one area where the government has actually attempted to curb or restrict this reservation policy for them. And also gradually, if these communities' lifestyle, their condition improves, then a lot of communities can be delisted from this list of around 5,000 communities which come under the other than backward class. And ultimately, we can reduce this percentage of reservation and give more weightage to meritocracy. But this policy is correct. I think they require this reservation, and this is enshrined in the principle of equality. Therefore, it is not correct to say that this policy is not good or bad.
All right, Jeet, I think when you present this logic, I think it looks logical. But I think at the same time, 4 to 5 generations have passed after we got independence in 1947. And initially, if I'm not mistaken, the reservation law was applicable for first 10 years, but then it has been extended continuously. And now it looks like that it is the right of the people. For instance, if I remember when I was small and in school, I learned, and you know, I remember that very hard-coded in my memory, that the president of India's is from one of these segments, and his daughter is applying for a reservation. So I think probably that you know, those kind of things which are being corrected now, as you rightly said, that if you're in a creamy layer, your family income is more than 8 lakhs, then you're not a deserving candidate to get a reservation. So I think you know, this is great for clarifying all these things. However, I think somehow we have to bring the meritocracy also, because India is a very big country. We have to increase the amount of business people do, amount of jobs they have, whether private or public sector jobs. And that is the only way to bring the equality. That is my opinion as a layman.
No, absolutely. You are right. Ultimately, meritocracy should never suffer in any country. So because otherwise the best brains of this country would not want to live in this country. They would want to go abroad and settle there. So yes, the premier institutions in this country, if they are also compelled to have this reservation policy, that affects. But then, so some institutions, which are the premier institutions, should not be compelled to have this reservation policy. So yes, there can be a way forward to
there's another point I would like to make here, Rajiv, and it's very realistic. I'm coming from the ground reality. Many of these guards and very low-end workers in our society who guard our buildings and places and all that, those are basically from certain state in India, and they are not belonging to the reserve category. Yet, they live in a very, very pathetic situation because their income is so less and they are forced to work as a laborer or a small menial job, leaving their family behind because they have nothing to do in their own state. So their situation is quite bad, and they have no reservation to help them also. So I think if you look at some of these category of people who are below poverty line, but yet not covered by any schemes under reservation, their situation is also very bad. I think we have to look at as a country and as one society where we have to treat everyone equal. So I think, what is your opinion on this kind of problems that we have?
So yes, Chandrakant, you are absolutely right, because based on economic condition, there can't be reservation. That is what is had been held in the landmark judgment of Dasani. So even if the government wants, they can't provide for reservation based on your economic condition. So even if you are below poverty line, there can be certain measures which would help to elevate your condition, and government can launch program. And there are lot of programs for below poverty line people. But based on, because of your economic condition, you cannot be, you cannot have, or you cannot demand any seat reserved for you in educational and public employment. So that is one drawback. But I think the country is looking forward for having reservation. And if I'm not wrong, there is some constitutional amendment which is to be brought in, where which provides for reservation to economically backward classes. And I think ultimately, over the years, if this issue, scheduled castes and scheduled tribes condition improve, then ultimately, the government can only think of having an economic reservation only for economically backward people. So their condition can improve over here.
Yeah, I think the government has started 10% reservation in addition to what we already have for the economically backward people, and cut across all category of people, whether they are whatever caste, creed, religion they are. So they are all covered under that, but that is only 10%. So I think gradually, to improve the scale of what we have today in our society, I think the 10% can increase by certain percentage, and the reserve category can reduce by certain percentage, depending on how the situation is. And I fully agree with you. When the independence was granted, then the people from certain segment of the society, they were not having any land with them. You know, at that point in time, the measure of wealth was predominantly land, because there was nothing else for you to talk about. But you know, that brings myself also in that same category, because we were city dwellers. We didn't have land. But I'm not talking about those kind of people who are similar to me. But then the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe did not have a provision to even have a land. So I think in those days, the reservation was very relevant. I personally feel it is not so relevant now, because the government jobs are 10% and 90% are your entrepreneurship. That means if you are smart, you can succeed. And I can share my experience also with you, Jeet. I've been in the industry for 27 years. I've never worked for government or any public job. we have had very fantastic experience, and we don't even know who was the other person who was working for you. So I think in the private sector, nobody talks about these things, but reservation is there in the government sector. And you have any last word on this?
Well, you are right, and it is good that wherever you have worked, in your experience, you have not found any discrimination. But I don't completely agree that in private sector there is no discrimination or they are not looked down upon. In fact, I think in the 90% of private sector where these people are employed, there is discrimination and there is subjugation of these castes. So, which requires some. But yes, ultimately, yes, if there is if the casteist mentality of this country goes away, and then yes, then there, I don't think there would be any such deprivation or any discrimination for them.
Actually, you are right. You know, I was just thinking about when you were saying these things, I was thinking about discrimination at workplace. It's predominantly in certain states. For example, if you look at Tamil Nadu, the divide is so huge that it is only Brahmin or non-Brahmin. So here you talk about OBC, SC, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, but the divide is so huge over there that it's all, you know, the top layer and everybody else is a lower caste. So I think, but even in places like Chennai, the prominent places in Tamil Nadu, I have not seen too much of discrimination. It used to be there 20 years back, gradually it is going away. I think all of us, people who are educated and well-placed, should not follow any discrimination of any sort or of any kind. And treat it very openly, like treat other human equal to yourself. Even if they are working for you, or if you are working for somebody, you should get the same treatment across. So I think with that, we can end our discussion today. It is a very difficult subject to discuss. But, you know, we wanted to bring this to you, to our listeners and viewers. And we welcome all inputs because, you know, today you have heard two sides where I am of the opinion that we should gradually reduce the reservation. And Jeet is saying that, you know, we should continue with it until we are very sure that everybody is equal. So I think there are two sides in this discussion. Like to know your comments. And please engage with us, and we can put your comments in the next episode with Jeet. So thank you, Jeet, for joining us, and we will catch up next Thursday.
Thank you, Chandrakant, for having me.